Hello and welcome to Dispatches from India, a show by People's Dispatch. In this show, we bring you the major news developments from India over the past week. Our first story is about the COVID-19 situation in the country, the responses by the government, and attempts by certain sections to bring about a religious angle to the disease.
The number of reported cases in the country is nearly 3,400, with the number of active cases at 3,030. As many as 77 people have died in the country as of the morning of April 5th. Many questions are being raised about the government's response. The first is whether India is testing enough and whether the actual number of cases is getting reported. Going by the numbers on April 3rd, just close to 70,000 tests have been done. With these numbers, India's testing figures per million population is still one of the lowest in the world. A number of experts have said that the country may not be aware of the true magnitude of the infection. There is also the issue of shortage of personal protection equipment for healthcare workers. The government took up this matter seriously only towards the third week of March, which was already very late. Doctors and medical professionals are trying to privately source much of this gear in many places. Dr. Yogesh Jain of the Jan Swasthya Sahyog talked to us earlier this week on the risks of there not being enough PPE kits.
Starting from 27th of February, when this call was taken on developing a rapid program to combat the epidemic, even the first 3.5 weeks, we did not see any movement about procuring the personal protective equipment for the people of the who will be at the front lines to handle the problems. But on the contrary, even in the weeks that have happened in the last 10 days also, it has been treated more as a logistics issue, as if that one has to get the protective equipment as much as arranging ambulances or arranging pathways in care in a hospital. Well, I would say that the availability of personal protective equipment is more related to the outcomes. As I can see from the fear and the concerns that my own health workers in my own hospital and health program have, and as well as other ideologically motivated organizations that I've worked with, there is a significant amount of fear, and which is justified fear, that they might have a risk to their own lives in the next weeks to come. And in that situation, the fact that that there is a looming risk of not having adequate protection when they will be forced to manage people has made almost a panic-like situation, which necessitates that personal protective equipment has to be there, otherwise there will be mass scale desertion, is my fear, from both public and the private hospitals that we have in our country. And in this case, in the public system, this will be remarkable, where already we know that the level of accountability is still now questionable for many people who work in it. And if this protection is not there, this desertion, this abdication of one's clinical responsibilities would be far more, even at an individual level of health workers, which both include nurses, doctors, and other support staff.
So the key question is, do we have the resources right now to actually produce this, or do we need to import it at this point of time?
Well, I think there are problems at multiple levels. We are also, the fact that the procurement has been given to one public sector undertaking to procure from all the manufacturers has, slowed down the process of procurement. But also manufacturing contracts being given out, tenders being floated, and people being asked to deliver those products. There has been a tardiness in that level also. At another level, we'll have to get some of these components of some of these protective equipment from abroad, if not the finished products. And that has to be worked on a war footing. something which is lacking. But I would add, there's another component to it. There's a lot of wastage of the personal protective equipment that is happening. I can see any number of politicians, bureaucrats and police people and other people in the administration wearing protective equipment like N95 mask, which is not something that they need to wear at all. Those should only be kept for people who are health workers at various levels of, who are working with various levels of risks that they would have to take. So, as an example, I would say, why don't the state issue a strict guidance for people who are not health workers, not to be wasting and not to be, you know, demonstrating their power by using protective equipment that are only meant for the health workers. Otherwise, you're going to have a system crisis where people will, you know, stop working. Is what my fear is. And if the situation becomes anywhere like Spain or what people see in England or elsewhere,
right,
where protective equipment have been found in shorter supply than what was needed.
Right.
In the middle of this, Prime Minister Narendra Modi released a video where he gave a call for people to switch off all lights at home, come out to their balconies and light lamps and torches on April 5th for 9 minutes at 9 p.m. This is to show the unity of the people in fighting the disease. Immediately, concerns were raised about what impact this would have on the power grid. This is because the sudden variations in demand during this exercise could lead to the power grid collapsing. This may cause massive power outages. Modi has been criticized earlier for his gimmicks during the pandemic. A few weeks ago, he gave a call for celebrating the work of healthcare professionals. But this ended in people gathering in many places, leading to the risk of further spread. A number of cases of COVID-19 in India have come out of a gathering of Muslim missionaries in Delhi during March 13th to 15th. The organization which conducted this event, Tablighi Jamaat, has been severely criticized for holding the event. However, a section of the media and supporters of India's ruling right-wing Bharatiya Janata Party have used this to run an anti-Muslim campaign. A lot of anti-Muslim hashtags were trending on Twitter, and a campaign is continuing even now on this. Left and progressive organizations have strongly opposed this campaign. In a joint statement, leading left parties said that these campaigns divide the united effort required by all Indians to battle this pandemic and defeat it. The Communist Chief Minister of Kerala, in a press conference, made this point very clear.
തബ്ലീഗ് സമ്മേളനത്തിൽ പങ്കെടുത്ത 60 പേര് സംസ്ഥാനത്ത് നിരീക്ഷണത്തിലാണ്. ഇക്കാര്യത്തിൽ പ്രത്യേക ഭയപ്പാടിൻ്റെ അടിസ്ഥാനമൊന്നുമില്ല. നമ്മൾ കാണേണ്ടത്, ഇപ്പോൾ നമ്മുടെ സംസ്ഥാനത്ത് നിലനിൽക്കുന്ന സാഹചര്യത്തിന് തൊട്ടു മുൻപുള്ള അവസ്ഥ, അത് നമ്മുടെ മനസ്സിലുണ്ടാകേണ്ടതാണ്. ആരാധനാലയങ്ങൾ, വിവാഹം പോലുള്ള സാമൂഹ്യ ചടങ്ങുകൾ, ഇതിലൊക്കെ ധാരാളം ആളുകൾ പങ്കെടുത്ത അനുഭവം നമുക്കുണ്ട്. അങ്ങനെയെല്ലാം നിൽക്കുന്ന ഘട്ടത്തിലാണ് അതെല്ലാം ഒഴിവാക്കണമെന്ന നിലപാട് നാം സ്വീകരിച്ചത്. അപ്പോൾ ഇവിടെ ഇതുമായി ബന്ധപ്പെട്ട് ഇപ്പോൾ പ്രത്യേക ഉദ്ദേശത്തോടെയുള്ള ചില പ്രചരണങ്ങൾ നടക്കുന്നതായി കാണുന്നുണ്ട്. ഈ തബ്ലീഗ് സമ്മേളനത്തെക്കുറിച്ചും അതിൽ പങ്കെടുത്തവരെക്കുറിച്ചും പിന്നെ അതുമായി ബന്ധപ്പെട്ട് അവരുടെ മതത്തെക്കുറിച്ചും അസഹിഷ്ണുതയോടെയുള്ള പ്രചരണം ചിലരടിച്ചുവിടുന്നതായി കാണുന്നുണ്ട്. സോഷ്യൽ മീഡിയയാണ് ഇതിനുവേണ്ടി വ്യാപകമായി ദുരുപയോഗിക്കുന്നത്. ഒരു കാര്യമേ പറയാനുള്ളൂ, ഈ രോഗകാലത്ത് വർഗീയ വിളവെടുപ്പ് നടത്താൻ ആരും തുനിഞ്ഞിറങ്ങേണ്ടതില്ല. കൊറോണ വൈറസ് മതം നോക്കി ബാധിക്കുന്ന ഒന്നല്ല. നമ്മളെല്ലാവരും ജാഗ്രത പാലിക്കുക എന്നതാണ് പ്രധാനം. ഒന്നിച്ച് നിന്ന് ജാഗ്രത പാലിക്കാനാണ് നമ്മുടെ സമൂഹം മൊത്തത്തിൽ ശ്രദ്ധിച്ചത്. അത് ആ നിലയിൽ തന്നെ തുടരേണ്ടതാണ്. നമ്മുടെ അഭ്യർത്ഥന മാനിച്ച് എല്ലാ വിഭാഗങ്ങളും വ്യത്യസ്തങ്ങളായ ആൾക്കൂട്ടങ്ങളുണ്ടാകുന്ന പരിപാടികൾ ഒഴിവാക്കിയ മാതൃകാപരമായ നടപടി നാം ഇവിടെ ഓർക്കേണ്ടതാണ്.
Another initiative announced by the Prime Minister recently is PM CARES, a separate fund for collecting donations to fight the coronavirus disease. However, many observers have asked why India needs a separate fund when there is already one called the Prime Minister's National Relief Fund. Journalist Bhasha Singh spoke to us on this strange phenomenon.
As fight against coronavirus enters into a critical stage in India, Prime Minister Narendra Modi announced PM CARES, a public charitable trust. It raised many questions, many suspicions around it. The first thing that why PM CARES, which is directly linked with corona fundraising thing, because already in India, there is PM Relief Fund, which is an accountable and transparent body. Then people started asking the question, and they are still without any answers, that why at this juncture PM waited all this long and he announced on 28th March PM CARES, which is completely an opaque body, opaque structure, which is headed by PM himself. And as far as we know, the members are the Home Minister, Mr. Amit Shah, Finance Minister, Nirmala Sitharaman, and Defense Minister, Rajnath Singh. Apart from this, very less information is in public domain. The biggest thing that this was not at all discussed in the Parliament. And as we know, that just 5 days before of announcement of the PM CARES, that's on 28th, it was announced, 5 days before, Parliament was in session and there was a lot of discussion around corona and how the Indian government is going to have a fight and what preparations are going to be done. It was discussed in the Parliament. So the people and the parliamentarians are asking now that when Parliament was in session, why not this PM CARES was discussed so that everybody could have been taken on the board. And the other point, which is very relevant, that when the Prime Minister announced about the PM CARES, at the same time, the PM Relief Fund was having enough money. It was having 3,800 crores, which was lying unspent. And the country was facing huge fund crisis to deal with the COVID-19 crisis. So why the government waited so long and it has not utilized this fund, which was lying with him? So this question is still unanswered. And the people who are raising, including the parliamentarians, are not satisfied. And the government has not come with a single line of justification that why the government felt the need of PM CARES and why it has not relied on the parliamentarian process or the transparent process, or why it has not utilized the money of the PM Relief Fund so far. Many public intellectuals, including noted historian Ramchand Guha and parliamentarian Shashi Tharoor and many others, are raising a question that whether this PM CARES is a PR, or we can say public relation exercise, or a new branding exercise from Prime Minister. That's why he waited all the way so long to launch this program. And finally, the biggest question is related with the foreign donations. Initially, when there was call from donations on the website, there was a SWIFT code. And as we all know, the SWIFT code of a bank is needed when there is a call for inter-country donations from one country to another country. When there is a donation, then there is a need of SWIFT code. And at the same time, as it is reported in the media, Prime Minister interacted with the foreign missions, Indian embassies, and there, through video conferencing, he requested all the embassies to generate and mobilize enough fund for the PM CARES. At that time, Swift code was there on the website. And when much red flag was raised, much questions were raised that how a foreign funding is generated for the this kind of a public charitable trust, then all of a sudden what we find that this code is missing from the website. So the biggest question now, when India is facing a huge crunch of resources, huge crunch of ventilators, of masks, which is very much needed by the people who are working in the hospitals, who are engaged in the cleaning work. They don't have proper sanitary gloves and masks. That why the country, when they are being funded so much, they have so much fund in the PM relief funds, and now with the PM CARES, how this whole thing to fight against COVID-19 became a political PR exercise of Prime Minister Narendra Modi. This is the biggest question, which is linked right directly to PM CARES.
And finally, here is a feature on the migrant workers in the country. Hundreds of thousands of migrant workers began leaving India's big cities after national lockdown was imposed from March 25th. It was clear that no arrangements had been made to take care of their needs, as many of them are daily wage laborers. Delhi was a key center of this migration, with people leaving the capital of India to walk hundreds of kilometers to the states of Uttar Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh. Let's hear what some of these workers had to say.
चार दिन हो गए बच्ची को ना कुछ खाया है ना पिया है, क्या करे
अब इसको आप पैदल लेके जाओगे?
पैदल लेके जा रहे हैं, 30 किलोमीटर पैदल आ रहे हैं, अब क्या करे, यहाँ से 300 किलोमीटर जाना है।
वाहन भी नहीं मिल रहे, खाने को भी लिए राशन पानी कुछ नहीं मिल रहा भाई, बहुत बड़ी समस्या है।
हम बिहार के रहने वाले हैं, अररिया जिला का
रहते हैं, जिला हरदोई है और गाँव पड़ता है हमारा एजा
सिकंदराबाद।
ये बदायूं,
मुरादाबाद,
बरेली,
ग्राम निपनिया, जिला रामपुर।
संगम बिहार से पैदल आ रहे हैं और संभल जा रहे हैं पैदल यहाँ से।
देश में कम से कम 10 करोड़ प्रवासी मजदूर हैं जो अपने घर से अकेले बहुत दूर काम करते हैं ताकि वो उनके वो परिवार जो गांव में है वो खाना खा सके।
हम लोग किराए पे रह रहे थे, वहाँ पे मालिक मना कर दिया हम लोगों को। अब हम लोग जो है रोड पे आकर के घूम रहे हैं, ना तो कोई गाड़ी है कि हम लोग गाड़ी से जाएंगे। सरकार का अभी तक कोई हम लोग को ठिकाना नहीं लगाया है, ना कोई गाड़ी है।
ये खर्चा पानी तो पहले से नहीं है, जैसे जेल दंगांगा नहीं हुआ है, काम धाम तब से नहीं है।
मकान मालिक ने निकाल दिया, बोले किराया दे तो रहे और नहीं अपने घर जा। मैंने उसे किराया दे दिया, 500 रुपये थे मेरी जेब में। अब 3-4 दिन से जब भूख लगी तो ऐसी बिस्कुट खा के टाइम काट रहे हैं, अब भी बिस्कुट नहीं हुए तो
अपने बिस्कुट खाते हुए जा रहे हैं,
अपने खाते हुए जा रहे हैं, क्या करें।
हमें याद करना बहुत ज़रूरी है कि इस देश की अधिकांश जो जनता है वो असंगठित मजदूर हैं, उन्हें घर बैठ के तनख्वाह कोई नहीं देगा, वो रोज़ कमाते हैं और रोज़ खाते हैं, जब कमा नहीं सकते तो खा नहीं पाएंगे।
कुछ ना मिलो है खाने को, गैस वगैरह, राशन वगैरह कुछ ना मिलो।
अचानक एक दिन अगर उनकी ये स्थिति हो जाए जहाँ उनके पास रोजगार नहीं रहा और भोजन नहीं रहा और ये डर है कि एक बीमारी आ सकती है जो उनकी जान ले सकती है, तो आप उस हालत में होते तो कहाँ जाना चाहते, उस जगह पे जिसे आप घर कहते हैं। लेकिन सरकार ने रातों रात जब ट्रेन बंद कर दिए, बस बंद कर दिए, एक लंबी कतार चलती जा रही है जो लोग कई दिनों तक रातों तक चल रहे हैं ताकि वो अपना घर पहुंच सके।
अब
क्या करें, ऐसे भी जब भूखा मर ही रहा है तो सोच रहा है कि रास्ते भी मरेगा साले, अब करना क्या है यहाँ पे, क्या करेंगे, पैदल ही चलेंगे अब।
That's all we have in this episode of Dispatches from India. We'll be back next week with the major news developments from the country. Until then, keep watching People's Dispatch.